Thank you. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Friends, we're gathered here today to give thanks for the life of a cherished friend, a dear Christian sister, Harriet Macfarlane, who died and went to be with the Lord on August the 6th. Harriet was in her 80th year and remained until the end a joyful encourager and caring friend, all that despite being quite limited for the past 4 or 5 years. And even in the weakness of her final month spent in hospital, it was marked by Harriet's ongoing care and concern for others, as well as her very sharp wit. She faced her decline in health with great acceptance and real thankfulness. And though she is now gone, Harriet's life still speaks to us. And it will speak particularly to us now as we gather to remember and to give thanks for a life well lived. And Harriet speaks to us still through the lasting example she's left for us, but also through the real and the evident trust that she had in her Lord, the Lord Jesus. And so, though the world will be an immeasurably poorer place for us because of her passing, yet even in the shadow of grief, we gather today in gratitude to God for the life of one whose presence lit up our lives simply by being among us. Those who kept up regularly with Harriet will know well that she was always concerned for others, and above all, for the ministry of her beloved church and Lord. And so it's fitting that we begin by singing together of the God who is forever faithful, who is faithful to Harriet and remains faithful still. We sing together, "Great is thy faithfulness." Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, who loves us with an everlasting love, gladly we bow before you in the sweetness of your tender presence and offer you the worship and love of our hearts in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Indeed, we come and we pray in Jesus' name, for we know that in his presence, even the darkest shadows flee away, and the light of life breaks in upon our breaking hearts with the oil of joy and the assurance and peace that only your gospel can bestow. So, Lord, as we give thanks for the life of our dear loved one, will you make the hope of the glorious gospel of Christ shine brightly for us in a new way to bring comfort and solace to our grieving hearts? For we ask it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, Harriet's nephews, David and Andrew, have asked that I share a tribute to Harriet. Harriet Macfarlane was born in the midst of the Second World War on the 8th of February 1943 to Harriet and John Macfarlane. In time, the 8th of February would prove to be an important family day, as it would mark the birthday of not just Harriet, but also her nephew David, born 26 years later on the same day in 1969. Harriet was the youngest of two siblings. Her brother John was 9 years older, and so it was a family of Harriets and Johns. Urban myths suggest the baby name debate didn't last very long in that house. Before Harriet was born, the family spent a few years in London, where Harriet's brother was born, but they returned to Scotland in time for Harriet to be welcomed into the world here. And she was born and grew up in the family home at 2 Lockhern Head Road in Steps. Harriet's father perfected his trade as a plumber and then worked through the ranks to become a successful company director in the plumbing business. And this allowed Harriet and her brother to be educated at Hutchison's Grammar School, or Hutchie, as most of us know it in the South Side. There's a story from Harriet's time at commuting by train from her home in Steps to school. Each morning at Hutchie, the pupils during morning assembly would recite the Lord's Prayer together. And for a time, Harriet felt guilty as she applied her poetic wit by saying at times, "And lead us not into Steps Station." After Harriet's father died, the two Harriets moved to Lindsay to live in order to be closer to her brother John and his family who lived there. And Harriet became an aunt to Andrew and David. And they shared many happy times together, whether it be trips to visit family in Dundee and Broughty Ferry, or times shared over meals. There was a particular fondness for the Christmas gatherings that would inevitably descend into Harriet recounting tales from her working life. Harriet studied and worked as a nurse and spent time working at the Glasgow Royal Maternity Hospital, or Rotten Row, as it was more affectionately known back then. And she was even on duty on her birthday at the day that David was born in the very same hospital. Harriet moved from working as a nurse to become a health visitor, largely in the Easter House area of Glasgow. And it was from her years at work there that many a tale was shared, bringing much hilarity. There was a visit where she stumbled upon two young children, one called Dolce and the other Gabbana. Or the time she got a fright as she suddenly saw something moving inside a furniture cabinet, only to realize that that's what housed the pet budgies. Harriet was always good for a story and for a laugh, and she took great delight in bringing a smile to people's faces, whether by her wit and her stories or by her generosity. But she was also a real help and support to new and young mums. Some here in the church were very thankful for the wisdom that Harriet shared and was able to give due to her work and experience as a health visitor. After her retirement in 2001, Harriet enjoyed catching up with friends from her nursing days, and they'd all regularly meet up in Barolo, the Italian on Mitchell Street. Her sister-in-law, Helena, John's wife, was part of that group. And both Harriet and Helena loved having that extra special bond intertwined into their lives. Treats at home often centered around nice food and the occasional glass of wine or Baileys. And Harriet was particularly fond of a takeaway from the award-winning Rasoi Indian in Lindsay. "You'll never taste a better butter chicken anywhere," she often commented. Her 70th birthday celebration retained a food theme and was celebrated with family over a beautiful but informal lunch at Gleneagles Hotel in Perthshire. That was in 2013, some 8 years after the same venue hosted the G8 World Leaders Summit. And to this day, no one quite knows who made the staff work harder, Harriet, or Bush, or Putin. Harriet also thoroughly enjoyed the friendship and the company and support of her Buchanan Drive neighbours in Lindsay, who were particularly invaluable to Harriet as her health deteriorated in recent years. She was chuffed to be included in the celebrations for the Platinum Jubilee as she took them in from her doorstep. Harriet treasured relationships, always taking an interest in other people, always keen to encourage and bless where she could. Someone told me just a week or so ago that you couldn't visit Harriet without being given a gift of some sort, and that was even recently when she was much more limited. She made many long-lasting friendships from growing up in Steps, from her time at Hutchie, from working in Rottenrew, and from working in Easterhouse Health Centre as well. And she also became godmother to Campbell, the son of her longtime friend Marilyn. She loved relationships and friendships and invested greatly in them. Now, it would be hard to talk about Harriet without also mentioning her long and deep involvement with her church, the Tron Church, this church here, which was her family. Harriet was brought along in 1959 by her school friend Margaret Allen, the daughter of the then minister Tom Allen. And ever since then, Harriet had became involved, very involved in the life of the church, always attending both Sunday services, midweek Bible studies, and she was very active in the church youth group. In the early 60s, the youth group, including Harriet, met on Saturday evenings in an office block opposite the church and held open-air meetings on Renfield Street. In the late 60s and early 70s, an outreach cafe was started on Saturday evenings here in this building that we're in today, and Harriet was a big part of that too. Another ministry Harriet gave much time to was on Tuesdays, her and Maud Reed, a church member at the time. Maud and Harriet would meet in the city centre with others at Maud's office. They'd collect bags containing hundreds of bags of biscuits, and then they took the bus to Forest Hall Hospital in Springburn, a hospital for people who at the time were regarded as homeless and down and outs. And Harriet would chat with the residents, read scripture to them, pray with them, and give them a bag of biscuits. Making these visits weekly in rain, hail, sleet, and snow, walking up the long drive to the hospital, often arriving like drowned rats, but happily doing so. Harriet was involved in so many ways in church, serving usually behind the scenes, in unseen ways, often in the kitchen, helping with catering and having everyone in fits of laughter. She loved being responsible for the tea and the coffee and the eats at the Ladies' Fellowship, which was a regular event for her on Mondays. And it was there that I got to know her some 10 years ago as she took me under her wing as a youngster starting out in ministry, keeping me right with the senior ladies and always there to encourage and help me along in what to do. Harriet made many long-lasting friendships in the church. At least one of those spans some 58 years. And she also met those that she would go on to become her regular holiday pals, Mary and Dorothy, with their annual trip to the south coast of England, a fixture that brought much excitement and anticipation. She loved her holidays and had a particular fondness for her once-in-a-lifetime visits to Australia and New Zealand, again with another dear friend from here in the church. And even in her last days, she recounted to Andrew and David from her hospital bed just how much she'd loved her many travels and all the wonderful experiences that had afforded her with her friends. They were truly special times for Harriet. And even in the last 4 or 5 years, as Harriet was housebound, she always kept up with her church family and the news of what was happening, always asking after the many people she'd invested in. She listened each Sunday to our services, was keen to receive the prayer notes. And the common experience when you tried to phone Harriet was to meet an engaged phone. Many times Harriet was telling her friends what was going on in the life of the church rather than the other way around, even though she wasn't able to be out. And right to the end, the reason for her joy, the source of her strength, and her bravery in such trying circumstances was her love for the Lord Jesus and his love for her. Harriet lived a full life, touching many people, providing many smiles and much laughter. And throughout her life, her faith in Jesus enabled and sustained her to keep on being an influence for good in people's lives. So Harriet Macfarlane, born 8th of February 1943, departed to be in the presence of God 6th of August 2022. And we'll all feel her loss, won't we? And because of that, it feels right that we pause now to sing together Psalm 23, words that were precious to Harriet and helped her through many trying times, words that we shared together in hospital, and words that were shared at her private cremation earlier today. So we sing together, "The Lord is my shepherd." To focus for a little on the verse that's on the front of our sheets, our orders of service, and around Jesus' other words that surround this verse. These are words by the Lord Jesus that embolden, that bring assurance and comfort. They're words for those who are troubled of heart. Now, Harriet's main request that she shared for this service that she'd like to happen was that we would sing Once in Royal David City, all 6 verses, even if it's in the middle of summer. And so we will do that shortly. But before we do, we can see Jesus' own words speaking the truths that are so often sung in that much-loved carol. So listen to Jesus' words, or read along. They'll be on the screen. Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." These are very tender words from the Lord Jesus, words he spoke to his closest followers, the disciples, as they were being prepared for his own death and his departure. Jesus had just been explaining to his disciples that his coming death on the cross was the demonstration of God's glory. His being raised up on a cross to die for the sins of men was a coronation of sorts. It was to be Jesus' glorification. But the fact of that happening meant that Jesus was to depart from his followers, ripped and torn away from them. And so in many ways, this was the worst night of their lives. Disaster was coming. Grief, loss, and sadness like no other. And those of us who have lost someone dear knew that well. We're left with all kinds of grief, feeling real loss, thinking on the conversations that can't happen anymore, regretting the ones we wished we hadn't had, and feeling a hole in our lives. And so it's in response to the disciples' despair and grief that Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled." When grief and loss and frailty and feel your way heavy, let not your hearts be troubled. There's a remedy to these things. Hard and common as they are, life, we know, brings many griefs and sorrows. It brings trials. Very often, some of these things are our own doing, sometimes at the hands of others, and sometimes through the nature of this world that we live in, that's stained and broken. But Jesus' words aren't hollow. It isn't just a case of chin up and crack on. When he says, "Let not your hearts be troubled," he accompanies that with the remedy. And look at what he says. That remedy is faith, faith in Jesus. He says, "Believe in God, believe also in me." There's a person we can go to when troubled and burdened. There is one in whom we can put our trust. Not some wishful thinking, but trust and faith in a person, in Jesus, the one who is a source of strength, the faithful and trustworthy one. Our dear sister Harriet knew that all too well. Knowing Jesus and trusting Jesus directed her life, maintained her joy in the midst of all the limitations she had in later life. Harriet knew this well. And Jesus goes on to explain that this is no temporary or passing remedy or hope, but it's one that will last and last forever. Because look at what he says. He says, "In my Father's house are many rooms." The anchor that can steady any life is not an anchor that's rooted in this world or in this life. The refuge and the help that Jesus offers is rooted in the world to come. In heaven, not on earth. Jesus is saying there's plenty of room, room for any, room for all who put their trust and their hope and their confidence in Jesus. There's room in heaven. There's room with Jesus. Now, we don't have to live for very long in this world to realize that we'll all face all kinds of disappointments and difficulties. We don't have to live for too long or experience too much to realize that if all of our longings are simply for this passing world, then we'll always be living life tinged with frustration and heartache. But Jesus' wonderful words of comfort say that there is hope beyond this world. Indeed, that's what his impending death was preparing. That's what he says in these verses. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again, and I'll take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Heaven is a real place, and we can be sure of that because it is a prepared place, a place prepared by Jesus himself. When Jesus says here that he's going to prepare a place, it isn't that he needs to go and build a few houses and make the beds and sweep the floors. No. He prepares a place for us by doing what he was about to do. He prepares a place for any who believe in him by going to the cross, the very thing he'd just been telling his disciples he was about to do. He opens up the way to a glorious future that stretches beyond this life and into eternity because he died. Because he received the wrath of God poured out on him instead of us. And so he has made it possible for us to be assured where our last home will be. It's possible for us to look forward to a wonderful future, a wonderful final home because of Jesus, because he is the way and the truth and the life. And he's the way to the Father. So if we come to him, we're assured of our future. But look also at whose home it is. It's open to any who believe in Jesus. It's a wonderful final home for any who trust him. But look at what Jesus says. It's his Father's house. It's the place where Jesus himself is. Harriet faced her last days with real bravery because she knew where her final home would be. It would be with her heavenly Father, with her Lord, whom she loved. And when visiting her in hospital towards the end, what she wanted was to hear the words of her heavenly Father that were her only real comfort. She wanted to hear once again the precious words of the Psalms that tell us that he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. She wanted to hear again that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, but you can come to the Father through Jesus. And she wanted to hear her Lord's words again as he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Jesus said to his disciples, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. These are the words that Harriet wanted shared with all who came to remember and give thanks for her life. She picked a hymn for today that makes known the Lord she loved and who loved her. And the Lord who in love reaches out to all who receive him. And Harriet wanted nothing more than that all who are here would know the same comfort that she knew in Jesus Christ. And so sometimes, you know, it's in the midst of the sorrow and pain of a time like this that we can hear clearly for the first time the gracious voice of the Lord Jesus Christ calling to us. But when we do hear him, when his words come to us, they come with mighty power to change the future forever. Listen to the words of Jesus. He says, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He's crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God and those who hear will live. Well, as we finish, do look at the hymn on the back of your sheets, this carol that Harriet wanted to speak to us today. And just look at verse 5 and 6, the last two verses. Words that echo Jesus' own words. And our eyes at last shall see him through his own redeeming love. For that child so dear and gentle is our Lord in heaven above, and he leads his children on to the place where he is gone. And so not in that poor lowly stable with the oxen standing by, we shall see him but in heaven, set at God's right hand on high. There his children gather round, bright like stars with glory crowned. We'll sing those words in just a moment, but before we do, let us pray. Our gracious God, we give you thanks with proud and grateful hearts for our loved one, whom you have now welcomed into your glory with great joy. We thank you for all that she was as a devoted aunt and great aunt and friend. We give you thanks and praise. We bless you for every enrichment she brought to our lives. And amid our tears, we rejoice in all that you enabled her to be throughout her long life. And we give you thanks for every remembrance of her today. We pray especially now for David and Andrew as they grieve the loss of their dear aunt. And we remember too Horace and Freya and Adam and Kyle, who miss their great aunt. And for Jill and Lynn as they comfort their families at this time. There are so many happy memories of family times together, trips to visit family in Dundee, all the happy celebrations together over birthdays, around the dinner table at Christmas time. Many laughs shared and many precious memories. May these times, etched on their memories, live on with them to make them all thankful for the blessing that Harriet was in their lives for so long. But we knew too of how dear a friend Harriet was to many others, and as a godmother, and to many here gathered as part of this church, many who will miss what a friend Harriet was, those who will miss their holiday companion, those who will miss their regular phone calls, their cards filled with Harriet's own poetry, and the loving and kind warmth that Harriet brought to so many relationships. And so now, O Lord, will you stretch out your everlasting arms of comfort to embrace them all, family and friends alike, in their time of sorrow. And we ask that you will shine upon them all the light of the Savior himself. And for all of us, Lord, we ask that the light of your loving presence will shine brightly, pointing us all to the great Comforter himself, the wonderful Counselor, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. We praise you for the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom you came to seek and to save the lost. We bless you that through his glorious resurrection, he brought life and immortality to light for all who trust him. And we pray that you would grant us all such trust in you, for you are indeed the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but by you. So hear us, our gracious God, and grant that we may also hear your voice speaking to us, that we may know the great peace of heart that only you can give, the peace that passes all understanding, and that in doing so, as you have promised, our hearts may no longer be troubled or afraid. For we shall know for sure that you are with us, and your rod and your staff shall comfort us in that sweet peace, until the day break and the shadows flee away. And so guard and keep us until the day when all sorrows cease, swallowed up in the victory of our glorious Redeemer, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Well, we draw our service to a close this afternoon by singing at Harriet's request, Once in Royal David's City.
Oh,
And now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Do please be seated. Please don't rush off. You're invited to stay behind for some tea and coffee and refreshments downstairs. If you just go down the stairs and at the bottom turn right, you'll see the room there, and there'll be stewards to guide you on your way. But do stay behind, catch up with Harriet's friends, greet one another, and perhaps share some stories about our dear friend. So make the most of that.